spend a month more time with lecture, because without the custom, we have questions and we will work out answering all those questions. And what I'm going to do or try to do today is we are going to try and situate ourselves within this discourse and see how it goes. You are supposed to work independently with those questions and know the answers. So the title of today's lecture is Robert the Subject or Object of Everybody's And in particular, what I'm going to do is I'm going to concentrate on the second part of the second question that will be entire debate for your 15-minute lecture. And the second part of the second question sounds like, what is the difference between organism and machine, human and non-human? So, Donna Haraway, amazing scholar, born in 1944. She tripled major in zoology, philosophy, and literature in the Colorado College. And just for a second, is there anyone here in class who tripled majors? Anyone? Okay, we do not have geniuses here.
Wow.
Okay, who has double major? 20. Well, of course, you don't have to triple or double major to be a genius. But imagine if you are studying zoology, philosophy, and literature. What comes out of you? She is basically not an anthropologist. She is a philosopher. She is a poet, I would say, even a lot of scholastic work. And she's doing this multidisciplinary stuff which no science recognizes as its own. You know, you are kind of encouraged to do a multidisciplinary study, but when it comes to the reality is that no science recognizes what you are doing. Well, Donna Haraway was lucky in this particular aspect. She navigates this conflicting context really well. She got her PhD in biology from Yale, and her main books are Simians, Cyborgs, and Women, and Situated Knowledges, the Science Question in Feminism, and the Privilege of Partial Perspective. So what I read for today's class is a chapter of her first book, and the first book came out in 1991. But the chapter was written, and it was already quoted way before. It was written in 1985. Well, what does anthropology have to do with that? That's a good question. What is the difference between cyborg and robot? What does it have to do with anything? And what anthropology does or doesn't? Okay, what is anthropology? Do anthropologists study cyborgs? What do you think? You think not, but they do not. All right, well, here we have Malinowski sitting on some kind of bench in Torbjörn Islands in 1918. And what do we see? This amazing, fully clad white man sitting in a quite relaxed pose among black people who are naked or partially naked, barefoot, and they all hold some kind of things, some kind of strange objects in their hands. What is that that we find ourselves interested in? Why is he sitting there and what is going on? Imagine him sitting, you know, surrounded by cyborgs and robots, what that would look like. Okay, so we learned over the course of this introductory course of cultural anthropology that anthropology does a lot of things. Imponderabilia of actual life. it is the one thing that we study. And you can tell me what's that? Imponderabilia of actual life. What does it mean, imponderabilia? Any ideas? Well, this term comes from Malinowski's account, right? Remember, we read it. Imponderability is something over which we ponder only what we could not really understand. Anthropology also studies what?
Ritual.
What else? Custom. What else? Are you reading my poem? You do. Okay. Okay, why? Why is that that we are interested in all this stuff? What is that that we are interested in? We find ourselves interested in them, some kind of people, some kind of creature that are clearly not us. We go somewhere in order to study some kind of otherness. That's a kind of main difficulty of anthropology as a discipline. It emerged as a study of otherness. And otherness, whether within our civilization or different cultures, is our primal focus. But is that still, does it still hold true? Well, anthropology used to study otherness, and perhaps otherness is not the only legitimate subject of study, but it doesn't answer our question as to why we are interested in otherness. Any ideas on that? Why we are interested in them? Yes? Very well. Exactly. We're interested in them because they tell us something about us. Perhaps as we read the account of these remote customs, then may emerge a feeling of solidarity with the endeavors and ambitions of these natives. Perhaps man's mentality will be revealed to us and brought near along some lines which we never have followed before. Perhaps realizing human nature in a shape very distant and foreign to us, we shall have some light shed on our own. In this and in this case only, we shall be justified in feeling that it has been worth our while to understand these natives, their institutions and customs, and that we have gathered some profit from the poor. Who is the author of that? You all read that. That's Malinowski, the very same amazing white guy sitting among non-white people. Wow. Outside must not possess the same kind of human nature, or they might not possess it in the same vein that we do. There was an anthropologist called Levi Strauss, a French structuralist. His main book is Tris to Peak, who gives an eloquent account of that. When humans from Europe went and discovered what we now call the United States of America and the Americas in general, there was something going on that Levi Strauss called this kind of clash of civilizations. Never had humanity experienced such harrowing tests, and it will never experience another, unless someday, millions of miles from our own world, we discover some other globe inhabited by thinking beings. What does it tell us? What kind of human nature did we encounter there?
It was used to be called Hispaniola to the Caribbean Santo Domingo. The native population numbered about 100,000 in 1492, but has dropped to 200 a century later. Since people died of horror and disgust at European civilization, even more than of smallpox and physical ill treatment. And that's a very problematic claim to make, because there is no possibility to make a chart and compare the number of people who died of horror and disgust, whatever that means, probably doesn't mean clinical depression, and physical ill treatment and smallpox. There was some uncertainty about whether they were men and more diabolical creatures or beasts. This was King Ferdinand's attitude, since in 1512 he imported white slave girls into the West Indies with the sole aim of preventing Spaniards marrying natives who were far from being racial creatures. The colonists' reaction to Las Casas' attempt to abolish forced labor was one of incredulity rather than indignation. So, they exclaimed, we are to be deprived of our beasts of burden. For a second, this conversation is going on about human beings. So what is the difference between human beings and non-human beings? No human could be bestial and divine in nature. And here is where I think Donna Haraway's goddess emerges. Remember the last line of the Cyber Manifesto? I would rather be a cyber than a goddess. What does it mean? Well, it has a great context. Let us skip the first quote here and dwell on the second for a bit. Not understanding of whether they were dealing with human creatures or some kind of different creatures went both ways, according to Leonidas Toss, just as well as whether they had encountered human beings. Native people, First Nations, were equally baffled with whether they encountered human beings in Europeans. At the same period, and later on, where we talk about the testimony of Oliver, the Indians took a white man around. And for several weeks, they mount guard around the drowned bodies in order to find out whether or not they subject to decay. Two conclusions emerge from a comparison between these two different processes of investigation. The whites trusted to social science, whereas the Indians had confidence in natural science. And while the whites maintained that the Indians were beasts, the Indians did not more than suspect that the whites might be gods. Both attitudes show equal ignorance, but the Indians' behavior certainly had greater human dignity. It is ironic how Levi Strauss, in this very account of Thieves, still reconstructs Indians as this profound otherness. So what is human and what is the non-human? Anyone? Any versions? Any ideas? What is human and what is the non-human? I don't know. There is an anthropologist called Pritchard who went to the museum, and this is my vision, I believe. He proposed the unity of believers. He is basically doing the following. He studies scientists who study rats, in particular baby rats who are subjected to odor stimulation in order to trigger within their organisms similar processes to what human organism experiences while subjected to asthma. So know, there is a number of experiments going on in this country, just as we talk about it, on newborn rats who are basically put in the chambers with gas and subject to gas in order to study how can we heal humans. Tinchoy said that he was reluctant to say that we shouldn't do it, you know. But there is still a problem going on. So breathers. Someone who consumes air. Some machines are also breathers. They also consume air. So here is the enigmatic figure of robot and cyborg emerges. Something that exists whether outside of the human altogether or partially within human and partially within the non-human. What's cyber? According to Bone Henry, anyone? The definition of cyber? Can anyone enlighten us who is cyber? Well, yes? Yes, that's great. That's one of the things. Cyborg is also a cybernetic organism, a hybrid of machine and organism, a creature of social reality, as well as a creature of fiction. And I went to the internet and there was a lot of cyborgian creatures around. So cyber is a cybernetic organism. And we know that there was a big history towards that first cyborgian organisms and first cyborgs were envisioned a long time ago. Some people would say that it dates back to the Egyptian ideas that you can mold a creature, pronounce some kind of words over it, and spill some kind of liquid over it, and it will come alive. There was this dream of humanity for centuries and centuries that we can have robots and cyborgs who will help us in our domestic, you know, boring tasks, who would help us to take care of our children, who would help us to take care of something about which we are not sufficiently endowed to be dealing with. There were cyborgian experiments of production of the organisms that never existed before, and that refers to the hybrid ideas. In 1928, Soviet scientists Sergei Burkhonenko and Sergei Chichulin revitalized dog's head. They truly did it. There were also experiments with two-headed dogs and things like that. But the question with which we kind of meet in this particular context remains, are we cyborgs? Are we these strange creatures with either two heads or some kind of parts of our bodies that are mechanical? Are we cyborgs? What do you think? No? We are not? Someone said no. All right. Well, what about the prosthetic things that we have in our civilization? Either to help us move when we are impaired with something, or even replace our organs, parts of our organisms in order to survive. Will you decide whether you will be wearing a suit? What do you think? How about our technology that we are constantly finding ourselves engrossed with? We couldn't detach ourselves
from our phone, and whatever is happening on your screen kind of affects you while no one else is affected. You are sitting in this particular strange setting, and you are basically hallucinating, right? Or you are receiving some kind of content on your phone which no one else is aware about. And where are you? You can forget about your immediate surroundings. You might feel all kinds of affect. Does it make us cybers? Are we cybernetic organisms? Listening to music, reading electronic books, smoking electronic cigarettes. What do I see here? This is Joseph Wilson, who also lecture here in this very room, standing in this very place that I now occupy. Ostensibly, this is a human being. But what is the context of this picture? Here he has a screen in front of him, some kind of light, some kind of another light, something else. He is ostensibly a part of some kind of process. There is something going on there. Would he be able to flip those pictures without these things that he operates with? But if we are cybers, are we cybers by virtual tools? It could be very quickly brought to absurdity, right? What's the big difference between electronic books and the actual book that you read? You can say that as long as you use tools, you might be considered a cyber. It doesn't really play that well. So the question is, where the body ends and the environment begins. It is important to remember that the robotic comparison goes both ways. Human being was also for centuries compared to a machine, robot, and therefore in our imagination, whatever machine we create and whatever robot we make, they all will resemble human beings one way or another. If you think about Foucault for a moment with his conception of meticulous training of the body, you would know that the body, this living organism, is trained into becoming a kind of a machine that would be an efficient warrior, an efficient worker, an efficient caregiver, an efficient anything at all. Contemporary theories of bodies, of body and mind, sometimes compare brain's work to the work of the computer. And I think that in about maybe 20 years, these comparisons will look to us as outdated as now for us, the comparisons between human body and the machine works, because, you know, these old-fashioned computers do not have, I mean, they do have the parts that the new computers do not have anymore. Take the mouse, for example, if anyone still uses it. I think I'm alone in this universe to use the mouse still. Okay, who can enlighten us? What is Turing test? Yes?
It's like the ultimate goal.
Exactly. This is one of the tests that was invented by Alan Turing, kind of a founding father of contemporary robotic discourses, which was supposed to help us distinguish between human and non-human.
And, you know, it was criticized in a number of ways. It was ridiculed, it was whatever. The computer should convince a human being that the person with which a human being interacts is actually a person. It's actually a man or a woman sitting there and conversing with a human. First, just machines which won't over humans contain human inside. And the first human which would win over machines would contain machines inside. Think about three areas which Turing defined as something in which machines would never outstrip human beings, or if they would do, they would be possessive of artificial intelligence. This is mathematics, this is chess, and this is poetry. And in three of those areas, machines well surpass human beings already, right? They have the greatest computational powers, and they are able to defeat human beings in chess. Poetry, on the other hand, remains this vague area where we do not really know what to make of it, because we are just not sure what poetry is, and we are not sure what should be considered poetry and what shouldn't. But think about this new Japan novel, which was released recently, which was written by a machine, and which was good enough to convince critics that it could belong to actual literary discourse. Garry Kasparov was the first human being to be defeated by the computer among the champions of the in chess. And ironically, it was his very defeat that kind of positioned him as a, you know, as a person who inserted his own name into the history of chess. Not his many wins, but his loss. Now imagine a chess player who is playing the game of chess with another human being through the mediator of the computer while consulting a chess application on her phone. Imagine that another human being would also consult the chess application on her phone. What does this make this assemblage? What does that make this assemblage to be? It's like an application plays with itself through the mediation of two human beings and a machine. Have you heard anything about Chinese Room, the invention by John Searle? Can anyone tell us what this room is about? Basically, you can name it, yes?
So it's to give an example of how the machine doesn't really know something, even though it can perform a function. So the thought experiment was, if you have a person inside of a room who doesn't know Chinese, but has a whole bunch of resources, so that whatever Chinese is inputted into it, he can properly go through all the books and resources, put a correct response, which a person on the outside who doesn't know Chinese would think of as the proper answer.
Yes, exactly. To perform the kind of intelligence, the operation that requires intelligence in comparison, so to speak, the higher order letters and the characters and the English letters, and to perform kind of the translation, you do not really need to be an intelligent thing, right? Any computer basically can do that. Mediation does not necessarily mean anything. Well, what is the division between the human and the non-human once again? What is that? How would you define what is human and what is not human?
Where is the division between them? Somewhere out there. Remember Boston Dynamics company was kicking its robotic dogs in order to just check how these dogs would perform while being kicked? The dogs were supposed to be sturdy enough to encounter some kind of hits. Have you heard that about that? It's like it was 2 years ago, I think. Yeah, when dogs were just hit by robotic dogs. I mean, they're not technically dogs, they're canine robots. I was thinking about showing the idea, but I always feel that. So the reaction to that was really baffling to many, because people were not comfortable with human beings kicking robotic dogs. And it was really unclear why they are uncomfortable, because clearly machines couldn't feel pain. They are okay with being kicked. Moreover, if you think about it from the perspective of the survival of this machine, it is a necessary stage, because ironically, these cute creatures are the machines for killing. They were thought of and conceived of the machines who can kill human beings. They were a military problem. There were different anxieties about it. Someone who feels at ease or actually enjoys abusing a robot can probably over time graduate to abusing animals and eventually human beings. It's like I can hear its whisper in my head. Or if you see the robot who is running down the corridor and suddenly slips on the banana and falls, you do have this kind of surprise and a really hurt feeling about this dog. Another fear belongs to the many century human fear that robots acquiring intelligence and emotion would exterminate human beings. In the 13th century, in Hebrew treatises, there were descriptions on how to create a golem. And golem could be a server in the house, or alternatively, it could play a role of a wife or a husband in the house. You inscribe on its forehead several Hebrew letters, and immediately it arises to life. Then it gains power all the time, and if you want it to keep within its limits, if it grows into this scary creature which becomes more powerful than all the people in the household combined, you erase these letters from its forehead and it falls dead. Stop kicking them before they started kicking us. Anders Sandberg from the Future of Humanity Institute of Oxford University in Ethics of Brain Emulations stated, in the future it's possible we will be able to create artificially human brains that emulate a real human. But what are the ethicalities and moralities of doing this? There is a term on Urban Dictionary, lesser beings, which means some kind of humanness, but not fully human. So that was the first moment when this term, already coined by someone anonymously, entered the scientific discourse. Suddenly, while we were speaking about robots who clearly do not possess anything of humanness in the way we thought about it, we were talking about lesser beings. But what if there are lesser beings who are also human, ostensibly human? Lesser beings. Some kind of creatures, to use Donna Haraway's word. Some kind of creatures
who are more fully adhering to standards of humanity. That is to say, they insist on diverging from existing in the form of a white, male, able-bodied, European, or European descent, heterosexual human being. Lesser beings are beings which are something else. They are others. They are they, those things that exist in some kind of different sphere of humanity. So why do we experience this visceral reaction if a white dog is kicked in our presence? Well, some would say that it's merely an affect. And what is affect? The good news is that, or sad news, is that we don't really know what is affect. However, our lack of understanding what is affect doesn't preclude us from using the term, and maybe even to the contrary. Think about Baruch Spinoza. He is the one who entered this affect into the circulation, this term, which is now a big thing in anthropology. What is here to be understood by affections? Now that the nature of being insofar as it is being has been experienced, we pass on to the explanation of some of its affections. It should be noted that by affections we here understand what elsewhere Descartes has termed attributes. For being, insofar as it is being, doesn't affect us through itself alone, as substance, and has therefore to be explained through some attribute, from which, however, it is distinguished only by reason. Hence, I can't sufficiently wonder at the subtlety of mind of those who have sought, not without great trying for truth, something that is between being and nothing. But I shall waste no time in refuting their error, because they themselves, in struggling to provide definitions of such affections, disappear from sight in their own vain subtlety. Well, affect, which Baruch Spinoza coined, is something that exists in the double nature of something which is being affected and which affects that. Consider Deleuze and Guattari, who lately brought it into a consideration in the main philosophical discourse. Here is the example of affect. Affect is best understood through the example. Can anyone read the quote so that you are not tired of the monotony of the voice? Could anyone read this quote? Yes?
The young girl maintains the pose that she has had for 5,000 years, a gesture that no longer depends on whoever made it. The air still has the turbulence, the gust of wind, and the light that it had that day last year, and it no longer depends on whoever was breathing in that moment. If art preserves it does not do so like industry, by adding a substance to make the thing last. The thing became so independent of its model from the start, but it is also independent of other possibilities, other possible persona who are themselves artists' things. Persona of painting and breathing this air of painting. And it is no less independent of the viewer or hearer who only experience it after, if they have the strength for it. What about the creator? It is independent of the creator through the self-positing of the created, which is preserved in itself. What is preserved, the thing or the work of art, is a block of sensations, that is to say, a compound of percepts and effects.
Yes, so the block of sensations, that is to say, a compound of percepts and affects. If you think about contemporary ethics studies, which are represented by Brian Yasumi, Michael Fossey, Lauren Durant, and others, you could resort to some kind of easy definition of affect, given by Catherine Stewart, who is an anthropologist here in the anthropology department, which sounds, I hope, a little more clear. Everyday life is a life lived on the level of surging affects, impacts suffered or barely avoided. It takes everything we have, but it also spawns a series of little somethings dreamed up in a course of things. Little somethings dreamed up in a course of things. The examples of affect would be nostalgia, jealousy, melancholy, sadness, excitement, envy, anxiety, etc. So when we are thinking about robots, we might think about them as about these nostalgic objects. When Dawn Haraway speaks about sci-fi, she speaks about the number of writings that were popular or on the verge of decline during the time that she was writing about it in 1985, which were basically concentrated on future and futurity, which gave us different kind of ideas about how, what kind of life we will live tomorrow. And now, when we read this sci-fi literature, it all is about a kind of literature which basically already covered with the dust of nostalgic things. When I talk about robots, it would come and be our helpers. Robots who would produce something in addition to the useful labor. Friendly robots who would be taking care of our children, perhaps. Cute robots, which are going to be our emotional attachment prosthetics. Toys, remember Tamagotchi, which went that far as creating an actual biological processes by means of recreating them within this egg that it was fetching in. Have you had Tamagotchi? Does anyone? Like everyone had Tamagotchi? Who had Tamagotchi? Who realized we have so that I can... Okay. Yeah. That's exciting. Remember, that was the first robot who actually pooped. That was the first robot about whom you should have taken care of. Robots mimicking biology and those fears that are now partially developed and embodied within the understandings that the robotics biology which now is created by the Boston Technologies. So in these expectations of revolt of robotic creatures, in this effect of fear and hope, in this danger, in these expectations, surrounded by unmanned vehicles, using the unmanned cars, right? Not driven by human beings, we are going to inhabit a kind of world which totally breaches the division between human and non-human, organic and inorganic, moving and static, belonging to organism and belonging to a machine. Something that is monstrous and something that is not monstrous. Something that is human and something that is not human. something that possesses the language and something that doesn't. Something that can experience emotions and something which couldn't. Something which has some kind of power over us and could give us pleasure, and something that has no power over us and could give us pleasure. This is the kind of the world in which Donna Haraway situates us and the feminist discourse. Thank you.